Thank you. So it's a pleasure to be moderating this expert panel today on data-driven marketing. I'll just take a minute to set context, and then we can, you know, jump into all the rich experiences they'll share with us on this. So brands today compete on experiences, right? You can buy technology, you can get skills, but how are you able to create those relevant, meaningful, personalized experiences, keep them meaningful through the customer journey, keep customers engaged with you through their lifespan? These are challenges that marketers are struggling with today. And apart from that, they also struggle with some very real and practical challenges like, you know, it's a complex omni-channel world. There are many more channels to market on today than there were, say, 10 years ago. Your attribution is a huge problem, understanding where the success is coming from. Engaging buyers through their life journey is a huge challenge. Choosing and deploying and making the most of all the tools and technologies, 7,000 plus tools and technologies, is a huge challenge. But I think most of all, the biggest challenge for marketers today is proving the ROI of the marketing that they're doing, right? And delivering these sort of engaging experiences, the key to it, or one of the keys to it, is really data. So today we have this great panel here today to help us break down what really is data-driven marketing and where has it come from? You know, how did it sort of, did it sneak up on us, or has it been in the making for the last many years? So I'm going to first, you know, invite all the panelists, and we have a rich selection here. We have Deepali, who is a practitioner as well as from a technology company. We have Neeraj, we have Santosh, who's from an agency, a performance marketing agency. And Neeraj and Uday, who are from technology companies, who are enabling technology companies. To hear from them, really, Deepali, let me start with you. Data-driven marketing, what does that mean to you? You've had a rich experience as a marketer. What are the key milestones on this journey that have brought us to this stage today of data-driven marketing?
So I think if you want to get into the origins of the data-driven marketing, in a manner of speaking, data-driven marketing always existed. Right, 24 years ago when I started working, you depended on market research-based data for marketeers to take decisions on. So that was the sampling-based data. It was limited. Yes, you did qualitative research, you did quantitative research, and you still thought that you were taking decisions on the basis of data. The CEOs for development of products, you know, the CFOs, all of them use data. I think the difference that has happened in our lives, and especially the marketer's life, is on account of the fact that now in the service industry, mm-hmm. a lot of the transaction data is available to you for you to be no longer dependent on research-based data, but to be able to actually rely on real data about your consumer. So that brings in the whole issue of, one, personalization. How do you use that data? And second, in real time, can you actually analyze millions of data points to be able to take, you know, decisions which you can serve then to your customers in real time? So the velocity of change and decision making is a new thing that's perhaps come in the last 2-3 years, and which is why I think, you know, we're sitting here doing this discussion.
Right. Yeah. So real time, doing that at scale, doing that consistently across all of the channels, these are some of the new elements that have come into data-driven marketing. Santosh, you know, you come from a performance agency. You deal with clients in so many different verticals. What, according to you, are some of the key milestones you see that keep popping up when it comes to what defines data-driven marketing today?
So basically, if you look at it, if you were a business which has been in operations for about north of 10-15 years, chances are you already have most of the data that you need to do your marketing more efficiently, mm-hmm. right? So if the space that I work in, it's mostly towards actually improving your cost per acquisition or lowering down, basically, for example, in autos, it is cost per sale. I work with production houses also now who want to know how many tickets have been purchased of the movie spends that I have done so far. Right. So in this case, I think if you look at the milestones, I think people are not, as I think we were discussing before as well, CMOs now have to wear a different hat to understand exactly how should I effectively spend that money, whatever monies I've gotten. Of course, there is also the macroeconomics of things changing. We see that the auto industry is taking a turn right now. So instead of us focusing on generating more inquiries, why don't we focus on selling more cars or selling more two-wheelers, essentially, right? So that's kind of the space that I operate in, where we look into, have you harnessed enough amount of your own data to begin with? Because you've been in the business for such a long time. Now, are you capturing how many people have come to your events, or have they, how many footfalls have happened at your events to the date that how many inquiries have come? And of those inquiries, how many have converted? And what do I do with the rest that's sitting in the ambit with me right now? Take all that data set together. That's your own first party data that you can actually leverage upon, and then try to buy third parties or second parties. First, get the first party in action. That's the milestone that they would hit. And subsequently, try to improve upon making that data richer and make it more cost effective eventually.
So that's a great point. So first party data has really sort of come to the fore as a powerful force for marketers to deploy it today in their activities. So Neeraj, let me throw this one to you. First party data, what role really do you see it playing in a data-driven marketing strategy?
Sure. So data-driven marketing, if I try to break it down into easy language, it's nothing but people-based marketing, right? We've moved as an industry from more of an inventory buy to a people buy now, right? That has actually helped in optimizing and increasing your efficiencies. In doing so, the first very important point to consider for a marketer is to have complete control and use of their first-party audience. Right. Every marketer sitting in this room or across has invested enough time and money in capturing their first-party audiences through various mediums. Be it be offline, be it be online. But the unfortunate situation still exists is, in case of offline audiences, you'll not have any connectors to them which can identify their digital footprints, right? For example, at Zeotap, we have our proprietary identity graph, which is powered by telcos and other first-party data owners, wherein we have linkages for offline data points and their digital identities, right? So suddenly, we can enrich the CRM system, and hence a marketer can make a more informed decision. What are the habits of this person? What are the kind of transactions he does? And not only it will help in better targeting of a particular campaign, but it'll be able to make more informed decision on what are the kind of specific products that I need to push to that person because of their behaviors. So that's the power of first-party data that the marketer has to harness.
And I'm going to come back to the point you made about the challenges with that multi-touch attribution, Deepali, especially in your context as well. We'll talk about that in a minute. But Uday, I'm going to quickly touch base with you on in the banking sector. You know, that's a sector you're familiar with. What really have you seen as the evolution? And this is one of the most advanced adopters of technology for data-driven marketing, this industry, right?
So I think one of the challenges we've seen in what you would call as traditional sectors, right? They've been around for hundreds of years, financial institutions, banks, and stockbroking companies and stuff like that, is that the whole model has been disrupted through fintech. So one of the things that data-driven marketing really now needs to also cover is not only acquiring new customers, but to actually how to retain the existing customers and the customers who become dormant, how do you make them active once again? So that is where I think data-driven marketing again plays a very important role, where you look at historical data with first-party data that is already available, usage patterns that you have from customers and their changing needs, mapping to it, and then again reactivating them to grow the value of existing customers and bringing back into the folds customers who probably have been loyal customers but have waned away because of the lack of focus that typical companies have. And in the case of banks, it is also about personalized offers. So all of us here in the room are victims of the aggressive marketing that most banks do in terms of selling credit cards or loans. But think about a situation where your bank really knows you and therefore is only offering services and different products which actually are relevant to you. And that is totally possible because you're already a customer of theirs. There's another aspect where a lot of us keep talking about, as digital marketers, keep talking about conversion rates. So especially very large companies, and in the case of banks, there are millions of visitors to the website, and only a fraction of those actually right now become customers. But there's also a huge amount of data that actually goes unused. So that is anonymous data. So data analytics now comes in to play there. Apurva actually spoke about it earlier. It is platforms called customer data platforms, which can actually analyze the data and make sense of it. Yeah.
Thanks. And we are going to talk a bit more in detail about these tools and technologies that actually enable data-driven marketing like CDPs and DMPs. But before that, Deepali, you know, specifically within your context, you're in the B2B space, right? And it would be really interesting to hear, A, what, as a CMO, you think are the key building blocks of your data-driven strategy, and also what are some of the very real challenges that you face in executing them?
I'm going to talk about what we do at IBM a minute later, but I wanted to react to some of the things that we heard over here. I think the push and pull that you have for a marketing team, and therefore the CMO, is really, you know, a lot of the stuff that these guys spoke about, that's possible, and, you know, get deep into it, which is the fact that you have your performance dollars that you exactly need to drive, you know, for delivering better and better ROI every year. But there is also the, you know, the art of decision making where data has started playing a better role. And I want to just quote two examples there, right? One is a successful one and another one is a failure, according to me. Okay, so I think the same banks or the credit card companies, they have billions of transaction points and they know exactly what I like and where I spend my money. But I'm still to see in the market personalized offers of discount coupons to the restaurants that I exactly like to visit. Right? So the technology is possible. The technology is possible. By technology, it is possible. But I think the limitation that you have in an organization is orchestrating that, and at what cost? Is it really a high margin product where you really need to do it? I think so. That's the limitation that you kind of face. You know, that was on the limitation side. Second example I want to give is from a broadcast channel. A very successful broadcast channel, not the first party data example at all. You know, in the good old days, how would you decide that, you know, really what news serial to launch, right? But on account of the fact that they were doing social listening, one of the general entertainment channels, they launched their first series on the basis of, you know, a lot of creative decision making, much like how Sanjay Leela Bhansali decides on what subject he wants to make a movie next. But I think on account of the social listening, they realized that some of the secondary characters were extremely popular, you know, along with the main characters. So they launched a second TV series on account of just the sheer social listening, you know, with the secondary characters that they had. You know, so this, I think this is the constraint that, you know, CMOs have to live with. You know, sometimes the cost may not justify, you know, the investment may not justify the results and the output that you will get. You know, it's beautiful to actually chase the holy grail, but, you know, where do you really want to do this? And I think the third challenge that you face, which all of us currently are grappling with, is that the technology and the stacks, and Apoorv made a very good point about the new technology stacks, and, you know, I mean, I wanted to ask a question, but there was no time, which is, how does an org structure inside a CMO organization need to change to be able to orchestrate the ideal example that he was giving? And, you know, that's really a transformation that an organization needs to go through. And there the challenges that you face is that all of us are at a different level of doing, for example, and I'm very passionate talking about the multi-touch attribution thing, right? Where, for example, at IBM, I think we're very confident about doing it when you're doing a digital campaign and you're looking at, you know, a fully digital response. But the moment, you know, and we do invest a lot of money in the offline activities that we do. The moment it comes to, you know, orchestrating that along with digital, then knowing exactly which model works, and we don't even really even have billions of data points in that sense, you know, for us to be able to do modeling, right? Any B2B marketer who's sitting over here are going to have only thousands of data points, you know, really to be able to do that, and you won't be able to do modeling. So these are some of the real aspects. So, you know, on one side, we have all the brilliant examples, you know, that were given here, but I think the orchestration of all of this, and the fourth one, I think, what percentage of your marketing budget goes into brand building and what percentage of your marketing budget goes into your performance-driven dollars is still a percentage that gets decided not by any, you know, it's not really data-driven. So I think those are both both that, you know, we kind of run over a period of time. So I think it's a transition that all of us are facing, and newer things are coming into the play, you know, pretty much every year.
Yeah, that's right. It is a journey. There's no end in sight. It's going to keep evolving for sure. And I think just to recap what you said, you know, people restructuring and reskilling the team to deal with these changes, then building in some of this unstructured data, the chatter, the commentary that you hear all over, as well as connecting the offline world to the online world, which is a very, I think, real challenge that a lot of marketers face. We can do all that we want to do with CDPs in the online space, but, you know, there's still a lot of business happening in the shops, in retail, at the malls, whatever. So that's a huge piece of the puzzle. Then, Deepali, like you mentioned, the orchestration piece, be it orchestrating all the technologies that you have or then orchestrating all the campaigns that you're running across so many diverse channels. You know, you have mobile campaigns, you have email campaigns, you have SMS campaigns. I mean, which one of us hasn't, you know, had that retargeting ad pop up exactly one day after you have actually bought that product, right? So the marketers' dollars are getting wasted. Clearly, there is no orchestration and the data is not talking to each other. And then finally, I think the piece about balancing the marketing dollars for brand building awareness, some of those more traditional aspects of marketing with what we need to do to prove the ROI of digital marketing today, which is so, you know, constantly a cloud on top of the marketer today. How do you prove the ROI?
Yeah, I just want to add there, you know, so IBM does the global studies every 2 years where we interview CEOs, CMOs, CFOs, CHROs, and the last one that was done in 2018, you know, this is across, I think, Sameer was sitting here sometime back, I think 2,000 CMOs across the world, Sameer? Yeah, so 2,000 CMOs across the world. And 76% of them said, and I'm reading from here, they said that their ability to make marketing decisions informed by data-driven insights will become the most important factor for their professional success. Wow, you know, yeah. So it's also about developing a muscle where you make, you know, data-driven decisions. So, you know, apart from everything else that we're discussing.
Yeah, and I think there's some very specific skills and structural challenges we need to talk about towards the end of this session. But for the moment, let me bring it back to, okay, enabling that data. So the whole process of building this data-driven strategy, right from collecting the data, managing it, making sense of it, organizing it, analyzing it, and then activating it actually to run campaigns. So there's this whole stream of workflow that has to happen. What are some of the key tools and technologies that a marketer here needs to know about to actually make that happen, to go from unified data to activation, that whole workflow? Maybe we'll start with you.
So I think an important thing that we was, like when we were having a discussion in preparation for this panel, one of the things that we were talking of is the fact that we typically, and this was actually spoken about in Apurva's session, is we choose a tool, we think we have a particular problem, we choose a tool and then we want the tool, we hope that the tool actually fixes the issue. But that typically does not happen. That's where performance you know, driven marketing agencies come in. But more importantly, as a marketer who's been around for some time, what I always really recommend is, what is the customer journey? So I think that's the first step, customer journey mapping. When you talk of a customer journey, you're not just talking about acquisition, but holding on to that customer and, the you know, as the customer matures using your product, how do you make that customer into somebody who's evangelizing your product? And that will actually dictate what kind of, you know, stacks that you put together. Don't fall for this whole go for one platform and everything gets taken care of. There are tools specifically for each who are experts in each section, so please go for that. And also try to first make sense of what all data sources you have. Thoroughly study it and come out with trends. So that is the some of the steps I think you should first take before you embark into the journey of choosing platforms. though I come from a platform company, don't fall for the platform guy's spiel.
Yeah.
Make your own informed judgment.
So once you have your use cases sorted, what...
To add to that, I would say, while it's customer... But first thing is, what are we trying to really... What is the problem we're trying to solve for, right? Have the cross-sells dropped? Would you want to increase from one to two products or 1.2 products for per customer? Or would you rather... So I have another case where we basically, if you look at an OEM or an FMCG, you have a huge offline distribution channel and you have no insights what's going on there, right? So if you actually have like 1,000 dealerships going on with you, what is that dealership really doing? So eventually if you get that data together, but why are you doing that? Because at the end you want to really lower down the time to convert of a person who's coming to inquire to the point of sale, you want to lower that down. So take a business problem at hand, break it down into these sections, and eventually the tech will fall suit. So if somebody comes and tells me to buy this tech or that tech, I first ask them, are you really trying to solve for first? And then we can figure out what tech falls in place. Chances are, you may already have it as well, and you may not have reaped the benefit of it yet. Try to put that piece together, and so that eventually it falls in place to solve the problem that you bought that tech for to begin with.
I think you're absolutely correct. And a lot of that has to actually do with what do you want to do with the data that is actually sitting in your stack, at your house, at your CDP, in your DMPs. One very important thing which I have understood talking to marketeers, talking to CMOs across India is not only they want to activate this data, that's a very small part of the entire data enrichment process. They want to make sense of this data, take it back to product, take it back to their sales teams, take it back to their market, and see what is working in a particular geography, right? I would like to understand more on my offline data behaviors for people, what are their digital behaviors. I'll take it back to my product team and probably will tweak a product to make sure that it is in sync with what my behaviors of customers are actually saying, right? So stacks and platforms are secondary to the actual outcome that you actually want to get out of it. That's what I...
Right, so the data that you collect and that you manage and you analyze has many more applications than just activating for campaigns. Sure, it will help you from product development, design, all of that.
But Chitra, interestingly, you know, while, you know, a lot of us will put up our hands and say that, you know, we measure everything and we're talking about the higher order data usage, once again, I'm just referring back to the study, 44% of the CMOs have said, okay, so it's not a small percentage.
This is a public report, right?
Yeah, yeah. So 44%, I'm going to send it to you. Yeah. And whoever else wants it. My Twitter handle is @DeepaliNair. Okay? So organizations, 44%, don't sufficiently measure and attribute the effect of campaign on sales or profitability.
Yes,
right? So the point is that, you know, we are also discussing the higher order usage of the data, but what is very interesting is that some 44% of the organizations are not doing the base level work. That's almost half of it, yeah.
Exactly. And for organizations that are not, say, e-commerce organizations, this becomes a crucial gap, isn't it? We're connecting back all that you do in the space to your actual sales in the offline world. But again, if we were to structure those building blocks of the data-driven marketing strategy for the purpose of marketing, okay, again, narrowing it down to that, then what would be the essential tools, assuming they've got their use cases right, okay, they've done their homework, they know what problems they're trying to solve, what are the key tools and technologies that they need to have, a marketer needs to have?
So on the being platform agnostic.
Yeah, exactly.
So first thing is, for example, I mean, you start from bottoms up, so you need to have your data layer in place first. It is as simple as having your CRM, which you probably do already. From there on, plugging. So basically, if you walk up the path, you need to first have a tool that gives you those insights, right? So again, many a times you may already have bought, if you have a website in place, you may have Google Analytics already in place, or you may have Adobe Analytics in place. You got to plug that data back in. Otherwise, it's just doing your website journeys and that's it. So push the CRM data back. It's a very simple conduit. Any of your engineers can do it in no time. It's publicly available. You don't even need me, nor do you need Neeraj or anyone of us here. The third step after that, once you have your reporting in place, then you need to orchestrate it. You need to understand which campaign should I run at what point in time, What creatives should I run for that campaign at what point in time? This is defined by your target audience. Whom are you trying to go after? That's why I'm saying you need a use case in place. Are you want to, do you want to lower down your cost per acquisition? Do you want to increase your cross-sell, or do you want to actually lower down your time to convert? Then finally comes the whole entire layer. I haven't honestly seen a stack of a single vendor have all of these in one shot. Many a times, the other point to Deepali as well, I think first thing that CMOs or even the CEOs of your organization should do is first not let people work in silos because they buy their own techs. And then eventually what you end up doing is like a big marshmallow of God knows what not you got in there.
Yeah.
And you don't even know what you're paying. That's the worst part. Your finance guy won't tell you because he's actually cutting the bills directly to the vendors.
Yeah.
So first thing is to get to know what they are. And subsequent to that, take up the stack and then eventually push it to production in the form of an activation, which goes through media, can actually instrument your call centers, can instrument your websites. Any of these will fall in place through that tech completely.
I think what is emerging from our discussion is that this tech stack decision, and Santosh was rightly pointing out, and when I was doing this journey orchestration at Intel, I found that most of the elements that I wanted to put together were already bought by another group within the organization, and it was a global license, and it was very much available to me. But as he rightly said, people were not talking to each other. Yeah. So I think a major part is you will have to be this kind of visionary, right? So as a marketer, you're no longer this esoteric branding guy who, you know, breathes and evangelizes the brand, but you also need to really start thinking through what are the pieces and really understand it. Otherwise, every vendor will kind of pull you in different directions.
I just want to say this. So, you know, at IBM, therefore, we call this something called a cognitive enterprise, which has got not just the marketeers, which is about the enterprise being conscious of how what Apoor spoke about earlier, which is, you know, stacks which are based on customer experience, which is about data-driven decision-making and, you know, the non-siloed approach. And that's another report, guys, that I can send to all of you if you write to me on Twitter. It's a very interesting report. But, you know, the practical challenges of what happens is that it's not an ideal place that an organization's born today and has a fair estimate today of what it's going to look like 2 years later, and therefore I go and buy the stack today. Yeah. That doesn't happen. You know, I once was part of L&T Insurance. We were a startup and a well-funded startup at that, and insurance was a mature industry, you know, where we did this. We went and, you know, bought the stack that we really liked. But you don't get that opportunity. When I joined Mahindra Holidays or when I joined HSBC, you know, earlier on, there is the legacy systems that you inherit, and there is only so much capital investment that you're allowed to do subsequent to that. You know, so that's a practical reality also that, you know, we must consider. And going back to the point you made, I think the biggest tool, you know, Chitra's asking tool and technology.
Yeah,
and
she's trying to sell something.
You know, and I'm saying, you know, people with the right attitude and skills, you know, training them, you know.
Yeah.
So the change management that aspect of it is, I think, the most critical part of it.
Great. Yeah, so I think silos, integrating the tools, the legacy solutions that you're left with that don't let the data talk to each other, but then of course the people themselves, you know, often, I think sometimes I feel like the system is set up to incentivize individual silos to perform in their area, right? And that's how the metrics are set up as well. And if you want true data-driven marketing, you have to integrate not just the tools and technologies, but the people, the teams, and all of that. And speaking of teams, I think we have just about 2.5 minutes left. So, you know, let's wrap up. So the CEO today, this was something we were talking about in the room before we came here. The CEO today is the Chief Customer Experience Officer. She is the Chief Revenue Officer, Chief Digital Marketing Officer, Marketing Technology Officer, all of these things, right? So, A, what if you want to be a data-driven marketer, if I had a dollar for every time I heard that term, right? So if you want to be a data-driven marketer, which all of you sitting here will be called upon to be, what are some of the key skills they need to be thinking of picking up, as well as how should they be approaching the new marketing organization, you know, the structure?
I think one of the things that I started doing about 7 or 8 years back, and that's what has made me successful, is what I call the sales first approach. So I stopped thinking about, what are the eyeballs I need to get, what kind of visibility for the brand I need to get. But I actually started first mapping every region that I was doing. What are the kind of sales targets, what product mix needs to be achieved. And then I started working backwards, creating the marketing pull that would actually create that kind of a sales impact. And I was sharing with Chitra earlier, in my current role, I own the sales number as much as the head of sales in my organization. And I am more of a demand generation director than just a typical marketing director. So if you look at, and that's why I also drive alliances, I drive partnerships, and everything else which typically a CMO would not be expected to drive.
Is expected
to. No, they are expected. I think that that's changing. So I know that in a lot of companies where I've worked, at the KPIs are very linked to sales. You know, you own, doing that. But I also identify with what he's saying. I remember years ago joining an organization where marketing was only measured on cost per lead. And, after 6 months when we figured, how to improve the conversion rates, the one thing that we did was, change the KPIs of every marketer in the system to cost per sale, right? I lost 4 people in my 6-member team of the digital marketing, right? I also lost my agency because I said, now your KPIs are also going to be cost per sale, right?
I'm glad you brought that, Deepali, because one experience that I actually like to share is talking with so many people in your capacity. The thought of learning, what data is, what are the new trends in marketing, what can data do for my organization, is actually on the rise. Is taken by with both hands open, right? And I think that's going to shape up the next big thing in this industry as you're living it right now.
Yes. However, I think that's a challenge. But learnability is a challenge. And how much do you invest in it? Yeah. So Chitra, I know you told us we have 2.5 minutes. So So over to you.
Typical roles that you need to engage with, when you're helping a client set up a data-driven marketing agency, who all are
so actually
key to
the
it?
Previous question, I'm sorry, but I think all you guys have to start thinking like an entrepreneur. So if you're running your own business unit, how would you make it successful, right? So that's something, if that's a skill that you don't have, I think you should start looking into yourself to check, can I run this unit by myself? And if I am, how much of a junior you are doesn't matter. Or how much of a senior you are doesn't matter. If you can't think like that, chances are you will hit a plateau somewhere or the other, right? And if you do start thinking of that like that, you're usually a problem solver, so you should be good at quant or analytics. And data and science, it'll come naturally, it's not a big deal. What is your question again?
I was saying, what are some of the key roles that, the titles that you're hearing?
I actually go across the entire stack for me to convince. It's best interpreted if I just understand their problem. Don't tell me what tech to use, what stack to use, what team to hire. Tell me what your problem is. It usually comes from top down. But sometimes I have seen super entrepreneurial guys whom I meet in conferences, etc., just tell me that this is a small problem that they would like to solve for. And they are actually an analyst inside an organization pretty big enough. And from therein, we can start the whole process. Thing is, it has to go across the stack. Most of my time takes in unifying an approach so that all the various business unit heads have to be brought into alignment to go in that direction. And that it's time taking, but I think it's worth the effort because you would have done a radical transformation in the organization.
So when you're thinking about data-driven marketing for building out customer experience, it's more than just the marketers. And I'm going
to
wrap up
here.
It is the functional heads, it's the technology people, it is, of course, also the marketing people who are then the glue to bring it all together. Thank you so much, all of you. Enjoyed moderating you today. Any questions that the audience might have from this panel? Or are we totally out of time?
Thank you so much.